Hi, my name is Chris Schrader, and I'm in employer branding content at UiPath, which means that my job is to create content like this podcast that documents our unique company culture, gives some insight into what it's like to work at UiPath, and hopefully makes you want to come and join us. I recently had the opportunity to head to Romania, where our company was founded, and spend a week in the Bucharest office interviewing members of the product organization from there. This podcast is the first in a series of episodes that will feature a few members of the Romanian product team telling their story in their own words. And the topic of this episode is the bigger picture: what RPA is, why it's important, and how UiPath fits into that. To start, I'm going to give you some background, and then we'll jump into some of the conversations I had with some of our product team. So RPA is robotic process automation. And to give you a really high-level overview of that in simple terms, what robotic process automation is the automation of actions that a person would take at a computer. So that can be as simple as filling out a spreadsheet with some financial information that you pull from some kind of invoice, and then go all the way down into deep AI and machine learning integrations that allow our corporate customers to really do things that wouldn't be possible without this technology. It's a pretty new industry. UiPath is one of the leaders, and our product team is responsible for building a platform for RPA that is all-encompassing, easy to use, and can be seamlessly integrated into enterprise environments. So without further ado, here are some of the product people from Romania talking about their work.
I'm William Bogner. I am a product manager for Orchestrator.
So my name is Bogdan Ripa, and I'm part of the product management team.
We're at the point, and probably this is like step one, where people look at this whole thing with software, with robots, and think these are the things that are going to do probably moving data around and, you know, doing some simple validations in probably that's going to be the norm in the next, let's say, 5 years, hopefully. We're going to get to a point where we can do really complex things. And that's definitely scary for us as well, right? And we do have these discussions, like, is, you know, you have your day-to-day work and you go through the tasks and so on, but you do stop and think. And I think that's wonderful about the people here. You know, how is this actually going to impact the world? Because there's a lot of negativity around the robots, but some of it, I think, may be well-intended, that there is this possibility that at some point the robots will obviously not take over, but take over a lot of low-end jobs. What I think will happen, and what I'm working towards in order to like align my vision with the vision of the company, is a future where someone who went through and did like finance, you know, will not need. So I learned a lot of like really cool things, and, you know, that there were complicated financial calculations and so on that I understood from the first year that I'm never going to use them in practice, because you need like 15 years to get to the position where you actually make that decision. What I'm hoping is with RPA, we're going to be able to lower these barriers, because a lot of the stuff that is repetitive, that is not so complex right now, you'd be able to do like right away. Now it's fashionable to have RPA. I'm hoping we're going to get to a point where it's unfashionable not to, you know, when everyone will have RPA. In probably like 5 to 10 years, the price of a robot will definitely go down, and we'll probably see those prices reaching, I don't know, probably $100 per robot. At that point, we need to create a product, and well, up until that point, that can be easily used by anyone who doesn't have any fancy background, any MBA, any university diploma.
The way I'm thinking about this is around democratizing RPA, making sure that anyone in the world can automate their own work. When you have a company that chooses to adopt our technology, it's a pretty top-down, meaning that they go, they hire some contractors, they identify the processes that they want to automate, then they hire some contractors or developers in-house, they create a department, and they start automating those processes. And this can scale up to a level, but the reality is that you're going to have a lot of people at the bottom of the pyramid that might need their work to be automated as well, but they will never benefit of such a program, because whatever I'm doing personally might not be The ROI might not be there for the company. It might be there for me personally, but not for the company overall. So empowering these users to be able to automate their own work and their own processes is going to make a huge difference. We like to think about this as, the same way you get a new computer at work, you get your office suite. So, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Outlook. The other tool that you would get is a tool that will help you automate the boring, repetitive part of your work. I want to think that people are going to be happier as a result of this, because nobody is happy at their job if they're doing a lot of repetitive, boring work, right? I can't imagine anyone to be, oh my God, I'm going to go to work today. I'm going to do the same thing that I've been doing for the last 3 months every single day, and it's going to be amazing. At some point you're like, okay, I wish I would do something else as well. And their engagement goes down, their job satisfaction goes down, they're not happy, and that's a problem. The second you tell them, hey, how about you learn how to automate your own tasks and your own work? There's two folds to that. One, you are learning something new that you can apply not only to yourselves, but also to your colleagues. Maybe the person sitting next to you can take advantage of the automations that you're building as well. And secondly, you get rid of those repetitive work items, and now you can actually focus on something that's higher value and more cognitive. We're actually using your brain the way it was designed to be used.
So we need to be looking at two things. One is the large companies, and my dream is that in these large companies, you won't have people that get home being unhappy because of what they're doing. I definitely meet a lot of these people, and they definitely know, right, that what they're doing is not so very cool. They don't know exactly what's the correlation between what they're doing and the company's strategy. So they feel frustrated at the end of the day. So I hope we get to a point where that doesn't happen, and jobs even with like very large companies become more meaningful, and a lot of these positions get a big upgrade. So we're kind of like still living in the 1980s with a lot of them. Well, we're using Control V, Control C now, but we're not doing it by pen, but there's not a big difference. And I want to see small companies that can really use RPA, because the difference is that in small companies, it's a matter of money and a matter of expertise. Expertise comes from how well we could do that product that they can understand without like having extensive knowledge. I think when we get to that point and money is not a problem anymore, we will see a lot of these smaller businesses growing, because they have these stops now. They have these barriers that, maybe I could do more, but I need to hire more people. And if I hire someone, their results, I'll probably see those in like 6 months to a year. But being a small business, I don't have the money to do it right now. So we need to get to a point where RPA covers all these problems, because that's the main step towards growing the economy as a whole. Because obviously 99% probably of the companies are small companies. The vision should be that at the end of the day, in 20 years time, we empower the small entrepreneur to do a lot more things with a lot less money than they do now, so that they can really focus on, creating value, adding value through what they're doing, and not on spending money doing invoices and accounting and all that. I see a future where the first two things that you're going to do is, you're going to go online, you're going to see what's the procedure to register a company and how you register a robot. Because, I mean, now you think, okay, I'm going to start a company, I need an accountant, I need a lot of people, I need a lot of these procedures to be covered by someone that I'm paying. I want to get to a future when I say, I want to start a company, so I'm buying a robot and I just need to figure out like what are the things this robot needs to do right now for me, because I'm in retail, so I have this like particular use cases, but everything should be, a lot more sorted out. I think there's a lot of money that's being made today from smaller and medium businesses through what we call, let's say, consultancy right now. I think consultancy has become basically a way of pimping knowledge, right? You have some people that learn some books. Everyone can learn the books. It's not very complicated. I've seen the books for, finance, a lot of things, and they're never complicated. Even the legal stuff is just a lot. So you have a lot of people that are, they're just pimping knowledge, because the people don't know, what do I need to do this and that? And, they're just selling basically the pages of the books they learned by heart to these people for a lot of money. That's another thing that I'm hoping that we won't see. So access to information and a lot of simplified ways of managing your business business and your needs without having to. Obviously, I recommend to everyone, you know, using a good lawyer, using a good consultant. But I've also seen a lot of these people taking advantage of, you know, people that just don't have the knowledge and pretending a lot of money because of that. So I'm just hoping that this gap will be, you know, less and less felt by the smaller entrepreneurs.
So as William kind of mentioned earlier, there's definitely some negativity around automation and robots, etc. As these technologies progress, they're going to result in sweeping changes in our society. It can be likened to the invention of the conveyor belt in that way. And because of that, it's controversial for a lot of people. It's scary. It can be definitely seen as something negative, seen as like a threat. And we really think and talk about this at UiPath every single day. So this next segment features some members of our machine learning team giving their thoughts on that topic.
Hi, I'm Todor Virgil, and I'm a machine learning developer here at UiPath. Basically, what I specialize in is computer vision using machine learning and not only.
Hi, I'm Horia Cristescu. I'm at the machine learning department working on document information extraction.
I'm Cosmin. I'm a product manager at UiPath, obviously, and I've been handling the computer vision project.
My take on why do automation altogether, I'm an idealist, and I just think that even though in the short term it will maybe hurt people, in the long run it will actually free up people and make them able to do more and less repetitive tasks and focus more on creative tasks and maybe not even need to work that much in the end. I think this is one of the reasons I enjoy doing this, is that it has a positive outcome in the end.
I think about automation, I think we are people, we think we are creating automation. Actually, it's more of a systems situation where the whole society and economy is pushing forward to automation. There is no individual person who can stop it. It's actually happening as a global process around us. We should focus more on the question of how should we spread the benefits of automation so that everybody can benefit in the end, and it will not help only a select few. I don't think it can be stopped, so asking a question if we agree with automation or not is like asking if we agree that sun will rise tomorrow. Of course it will, so it doesn't depend on us. We just have to be prepared and to guide the effects of automation in the best human possible way towards everybody.
I think we as a society need to take a much closer look to all this automation, because there are a lot of discussions, for example, about taxing robots and stuff like that, which sort of makes sense, but if you look probably closer to it, I don't think it actually works. The way I see it, everything about humans is automation. Since we started probably throwing rocks at each other and sticks and stuff like that, then building machines and in agriculture, Excel is just an automated adding machine. Everything is automation. I think the deeper look that we have to take is at how we ensure that humans are not left out of this automation trend. And how all of society can benefit from it. The risk is that a few companies will own much of the world wealth and people will have nothing to do. Me probably being one of the laziest persons in this company, that's why I love automation. I think that's a great thing. The only thing that's missing is how we redistribute this wealth and this new added performance, let's say, of doing work.
It's not only a matter of redistributing profits. I think it's also a problem of redistributing the automation itself, because if people have access to implement their own solutions for their own problems, they don't actually need some big corporations to share a slice of their profits with them by universal basic income and such programs. We could possibly make people self-sufficient or more towards self-sufficiency than we are now, and that would also solve the problem of everybody. If you can rely on yourself and don't need much external help, then you are okay.
One of the things I also love about UiPath is that it actually chose to give its software for free for the community. So it actually does exactly what Horia said, is basically empowering every individual at home, so to say, or in a small business. And we're lowering this knowledge barrier each day. That's why we are doing computer vision, to broaden the reach, both in what can be automated and by whom.
And in general, in the AI field, almost everything is open. All the papers you can read without any problem. You can get implementations, you can get even data sets. Everything, also courses, lots of courses and learning material is open and free. So if you want to do something using AI, nothing can stop you. You have all the tools at your hands, just like we did here. We are riding on the shoulders of giants here. Everybody has participated. Some have created the framework, others have invented a new architecture, and so on. And we benefit from all of that, and we hope to return something back to the community.
We as a company have invested a lot into figuring out how to get automation imbued into various communities around the world and also into the education system. This has an altruistic side to it, but also obviously it benefits us. The more people that can use our products, the more widely they will be adopted. So it's kind of a win-win the way we see it. All of this leads to some fascinating discussions about the future. Like, what does a world look like where people grow up with this kind of automation just fundamentally as something that they understand and that they use on a daily basis? How do they approach starting a business? We can already sort of see this with kids today. And as they grow into adults and as the next generations continue, the potential is just incredible.
Yeah, I mean, and we're seeing a lot of that today, right? I mean, kids these days... I know my kids are just getting used to technology like nobody else. They talk to Alexa all the time. They play on their devices as if they were there forever. And, you know, sometimes you step back and you have to remind them, hey, you know, when I was your age, I didn't have a phone. And my phone was a landline phone that they don't even know what that is today, right? So they get used to that. They get used to technology. And they grow up and they will become part of our working society at some point. And they come with those expectations. They expect computers to talk to each other. They expect things to just happen. They don't expect to come to work and do boring stuff. They expect to do, you know, creative type work.
All in all, what we do here at UiPath is accelerate human achievement. Our mission is to find ways for RPA to take away all of the mundane tasks that no one wants to do and free them up to do more interesting creative work. That's what this industry is all about, and we're already seeing that play out at our clients every single day. Beyond that, we believe in psychological safety, in creating a really positive culture within the workplace, and empowering the people that work here to bring their best selves to work and live to their fullest potential. We'll talk a lot more about that in the upcoming episodes in this series, so stay tuned. And if you're interested in learning more, go to uipath.com/careers, and you can see our openings. We're hiring in all different departments all around the world, and we are looking for smart, humble people.